Hey YouTubers, I've been watching a bunch of videos lately on these rocket stoves, and I've decided I need one. So this video will be pretty much just gratuitous. I haven't brought nothing new to the table. I haven't discovered any way to make these things burn hotter or more efficient. I'm just gonna build one with the materials I have on hand and some ideas I've gotten from other YouTubers out there. I think we probably have most everything available here on the farm. May have to buy a little vermiculite. We have some. I don't think we have enough, but everything else should be free. I got a tank from a neighbor. Let's see if we can. The lighting in here is not very good. This is a Freon recovery tank, refrigerant recovery tank, and I'd much rather cut on this thing than a propane tank. That's nerve-wracking. My neighbor gave us the tank. We're good to go there. I was just going to try to gather up some of the materials today. We'll go out behind the barn and see if we can't find some tubing. We'll make ours out of square tubing. That should be plenty. Okay. The only other thing is vermiculite, and that's down in the potting shed. Probably have to buy a little bit of that, but other than that, we're going to get started on this probably tomorrow, looking mosquitoes, and see you first thing, probably get these valves off. I plan on just tracing out the square for the tubing and cutting this with an angle grinder. Cut us a square down here for the feed tube to come out. Leave the base on it. Cut this top off. Fill it full of vermiculite. Get your tube in there. Weld it back up. Paint it. Well, we're back in the shop today. We're going to work on getting the valves off on this rocket stove cylinder that we're going to use. Hopefully we won't have too much trouble. I've seen some guys out there using hammer and chisels. We're going to try to avoid doing that and just hopefully just manhandle these things off. So let's see how this works out. Look, that's tighter than Dick's hat band, isn't it? It looks like we're going to have to cut this off because we was going to trace this out up here, but it's going to be in the way. Now we could move this forward and just take the whole thing out, but that wouldn't be centered and just look stupid. We're too cool for that. We got to have this thing's got to be cool looking, not just functional. So we're going to go ahead and start cutting on this right here, and then we'll come back and trace this out. So let's just see. Kind of eyeball it. I'm not so sure they welded this handle on straight. I think that looks pretty good. Close. Okay, so we got our line traced out for our tubing. So I think the way we're going to cut this, because we don't own a plasma cutter, is we're just going to plunge cut these edges with the cutoff wheel and an angle grinder, and then probably finish them out with a Sawzall or something. So let's just... Success. We got to back up here because I've been editing the video as we go along because editing video is monotonous. Here's what we need to explain that I noticed that we just did it without saying anything about it. Is how we got the lines. How we figured out where we were going to cut this in relation to this hole so that it lined up. Well, the way we traced this out, of course, was with the tubing. And in order to get the location, we just eyeballed it. So, there you have it. Okay, so what we've got done is we've cut our 45s on our square tubing. Just like that. But we had a glitch, and I figured... I don't want to talk too much, but I think for those of you that are trying to build one of these and maybe watch how we built it, we didn't video the cutting of these 45s because we didn't do it here in our shop. The south fence line borders a machine shop. That's our neighbors. They're friends of ours. And when I went to put this 4-inch tubing in our chop saw, it wouldn't do a 45. So I called him, he said, come on over. I threw the metal over the fence, climbed over, and his chop saw will cut a 45. So real quick, let me show you what we would have done had we not had good neighbors with kick-ass tools. And I'll show you also why ours won't cut a 45, and I'll explain why his did. So if we could get Jerry to hold the camera, instead of hiding because he's afraid he's going to end up in a video. Real quick, I'm going to show you what we would have done had we not had a good saw or neighbor. So, damn, I'm trying to hurry so we don't run up a bunch of, here we go, soapstone. So, speed square. Rafter square, and there's another name, I don't care what you call it. I grew up calling these speed squares. And remember, Jerry, you have to hold it up and angle it down because them cameras don't.
Okay.
Maybe a little more. That's probably, y'all can probably see this. So what we would have done is we would have used this to trace out the 45. Just like that. Flip it. You could have, if your edge wasn't straight, you would have drew a line and connect these corners. Boom, and then these two right here should line up, and that's perfect. So what we would have done now is, just like we cut the top and the front, angle grinder, cut off wheel, you know, do each side, do one at a time. If this side's true, skip it. I mean, just cut right to the corner, because Your other end, you can let it run wild. It's going to stick way up out at the top, but that's not going to matter because then you can measure and then cut that off. And a cross cut, our saw will do, just not a 45. So real quick, let's go out here and I'll show y'all. Damn, it's smoky in here. We had to bring our barbecue up under the awning of our workshop because it started raining. And I think it's filling the shop full of smoke. Anyway, okay, real quick. So here's the issue. On a 45, it hits the blade. Just like that. So you could probably start your cut with a angle grinder and a cutoff wheel and cut you a knot and then slide this up under there, clamp it, and finish the cut. Okay, so the reason why the neighbors will cut it is because this is a Makita and this doesn't move. The neighbor has a DeWalt and this whole fence moves forward and this moves forward. So you can pull all this fencing forward and then you're out here and you can get up under it. So that's the deal. That's why we went ahead and just ran over there, had them cut this off. And now we're gonna get ready to weld it up. This end's not true, but I don't care because we're gonna let it run wild for now until we figure out where we wanna cut it off. And that depends on what we're gonna use for a pot holder. But the little short feed tube piece, I do need to bring it in here and true it up. So I'm going to set this back straight and clamp all this down and not waste y'all's time. Y'all know how that works. Okay, so I lied. This won't actually cut through a 4-inch on a cross cut either. But it's easy enough to rotate it. But what we're going to do is, you can see this thing is not true. So I'm going to true this up on the saw. And then we're ready to weld, and I don't think y'all really care about seeing me cut through this, so we're just gonna turn the camera off, save some time, and we'll get back to you. Okay, I don't think I mentioned it earlier in the video. We was out digging around, and we found this wooden wagon wheel hub ring. Is that what these are called? I don't know, but I think this will be way better than using this handle to hold the pots and pans. Now this pan's a little ridiculous. Anything gonna hold one that big. I'm talking about the little pans. I think we'd end up, like I said, welding rod through here to make a grate. And this is a little tall and I didn't like the oval shape, so I think we're actually gonna cut this off and weld that on there instead. And this will be our holder. And on the back we'll weld us a handle like Kevin Bacon did in his video. So it's just four little welds. We'll just angle grind that stuff and knock that thing off. So we'll do that real quick. Trying to do is get everything cut before we carry this over to the new shop. That's where we've already moved the welder into the new shop. So what I wanted to do on this before we weld it up is get a template and then cut the shelf that's going to go in here with the little air gap under it. So I think I'll just make I have no clue what the specifications are for this or what makes them one better than the other. So I'm going to use a 3/4 inch piece of wood just to give me a 3/4 inch space. And I've already made this little template, just cardboard, out of trial and error because I just wanted to see what kind of shelf sticking out the front looked cool. So you don't even need a shelf out front, but I just thought, you know, that's going to look pretty neato. And I don't know how far this is supposed to extend in here, but I was thinking, and I figured if you have if the burn chamber actually starts here, so you'll have a 4-inch square burn chamber, then I didn't think this shelf needs to go any farther back than that. First of all, that's less cutting for me, and second of all, I don't actually think it's supposed to go that far back, because your wood would be up here and just falling off into a little piece, and that air would have to come all the way back around. But here, the air is going to be coming out right here, and you get this full 4 inches of burn. That's my theory. Don't know, but I think that's how that's going to work. So now I got to go find something that's wide enough for me to cut this out of. And once we get this cut out, we're ready to carry all these parts over to the new shop and start welding them up. And I did find the gate handle. I'm just going to weld this on the back of the tank. I figure we'll just weld it back here like this, and y'all can see that, and then we can carry this thing around. Yeah, so we got this piece of channel we cut off from behind the barn. It's wide enough that we could use this flat interior for our shelf. So I'm just going to lay this in here and get us an awl, a scribe, scratch this out, use the primer and the dirt. That'll be good enough. We'll get that out there on the bandsaw and get this cut out. Okay, we're gonna have to back up a little bit because our battery went dead, and we only got the camera to come on just for a little brief second while we were cutting out our shelf, our little template on the bandsaw. Of course, you didn't miss anything. I mean, y'all know what it's like to cut stuff out on a bandsaw, but this is what we got done. So it's gonna look like that. And I've got my little board in there, my spacer. And then I've clamped this, and I had to shim it back here with this screwdriver because this tube's a little cockeyed. So to get this thing to set in here straight, I just shimmed it, and that way I could get everything clamped down and smooth this off with the angle grinder and kind of round it up. So it ended up looking good. That's about the way I pictured it. I'd seen an image on the Google Images of a guy that had a shelf that looked similar. So what we plan on doing now is we're going to just tack weld it in here, and then I'll weld it in here and bring that weld out around this edge right here. I can't remember what all we missed in the last video. Basically, you saw us, we just used a 6-inch piece of receiver, and down inside the receiver is where I laid that template, which I don't know where it went. It was around here. It's gone now. But anyway, what you missed on the bandsaw is the first thing I did was where each end of that receiver bent up, I'd basically just run it through the bandsaw and cut them parts that were sticking up off. So all we had was a flat piece of metal, and it had our template scribed on it, and I just cut out around the edges. So that's all you really missed. No big deal. So pretty much I think it's time to go to the new workshop and start welding. Okay, folks, we've got all of our stuff carried over here to the new shop. So I've got this set up in the floor, and basically we're just gonna weld in here and then come out around the edge of this. I already tacked this one back here, and I got this set up. I had it a little hot. So, most of you guys probably know more about welding than I'll ever know, but for those that don't, we're going to use a 6011 rod because they're good at burning through rusty, painted, dirty metal, and everything around here dirty. So, on the welder, we're going to try DC negative because it doesn't penetrate as deep. Keep kind of a lower temperature because this metal's pretty thin. So, what I'm going to do is go ahead and weld this, and then we're going to take our
45, and we're gonna weld this 45 here. And for those that don't know, you don't just start a weld and just take off, because what's gonna happen is it's gonna contract and it's gonna pull that in, and then you're gonna have a gap on the other side that you can't close. So you just tack it on all the four edges, or at least that's what I do, and then go back and weld it solid. So we're gonna get the welding. Okay, so what we've realized is since we've already put our shelf in here, we're going to have to basically either cut the whole top off, and that still ain't going to work because we've got the shelf needs to go through this opening. So what we're going to do is just cut us a section out of this up to the bin like this. And then cut this out, stick this in, then we can get our measurements of how high we want it on top. Mark it, take it out, cut it, and put it back in here. You can tack it at the top, fill this full of vermiculite, and then weld this little plate back in and grind it smooth. I don't think it's gonna show that much. This is just an old rustic rocket stove, so no biggie. So we're gonna cut this out and get back to you. Okay, so we ended up having to cut a little bit out on the back side too to get this square tubing in here. Probably next time we're gonna have to not put this in yet. I think it'd be easier if we didn't do the shelf. But so now we're gonna use this round thing. We did cut the handle off. I like this wagon hub ring better. So we're basically gonna just mark this where we think we want it, and then we'll pull this out, cut it off. And then we should be able to weld this back up and put our little pieces back in. Make sure all this is level. So we're gonna mark this and cut it and get back to you. Okay, we're ready to start tacking all this stuff together. I think we got all our parts cut out. So we got, this is level. Got it held in place with a magnet. So I'm just gonna tack it up here. I'm gonna tack our plate back in. I'm gonna leave this one out so we can fill it with the vermiculite back there. I'll probably go ahead and tack this on back here. This I'll leave off for now because I want to weld this solid and I want to buff all these labels off. So I'm gonna get to tacking, and after we get all this thing welded up and the vermiculite in here, I'm gonna use this little where that valve came out, and I'm gonna try to make something to relieve pressure. So when this gets hot inside it, I have a little place for it to relieve pressure. So I got some ideas for that. So let's get to tacking, and we'll get back to you. Okay, we got this thing welded up. I tacked it, and then after I got everything tacked, I just went around and started welding up solid. So I think it's gonna look pretty cool. What we'll do now is we'll clean everything up with the angle grinder. I'll grind these labels off and clean up some of my crappy welding. And we still got this little piece that goes back in here, but we'll do that after we fill it full of vermiculite. Now, Kevin Bacon had his handle like this, like a gunslinger. I think I'll go with, like, I turn mine this way, more like the ape man. So we're going to get to grinding and cleaning, and then we'll come back and start packing this full of vermiculite. Now we're going to fill this full of vermiculite. And like I said earlier, this is all we had in the potting shed, so I had to run to Home Depot. I got this big old bag here for $20 plus tax. Lowe's carries it too. So we're going to start pouring this in, hopefully without making a mess. We got all this kind of started the grinding process. See, that was 8 quarts. Looks like it brought it up to about here. Excuse you, dog. That ought to do it. Now we'll just weld our little access port up and keep cleaning and grinding. Now we had to do something up here to let out some pressure, because according to Kevin Bacon, if you seal these up real good, it's possible they could heat up inside, build up pressure, maybe rupture this tank or split it, and could, you know, that could hurt somebody. So better to be safe than sorry. So what we did is, where this old valve came out, we didn't weld it solid. So what I did was I made a little washer and I cut it to fit, and I put a, just rolled a rivet over so it can kind of set in there like that, and we'll weld this solid. And then if it gets too much pressure, this rivet can let off steam or whatever it's going to let off and maybe keep us safe. I don't know if it'll work. It looks like it will. So we're going to try that, and we'll get this welded up, and then I think we're going to start sanding on this and get it ready for the ring at the top. And once we get this tacked on, then we're ready to paint. And I guess we'll do a separate video when we fire it up and test it. So we'll get this welded and get back to you. Well, here it is. It's finally finished. We got the paint on it and it's drying. Man, this thing looks really cool. It was a pretty fun project. We had some meltdowns during this project that y'all missed. Maybe I'll do an outtake, rant, tangent video, and we'll get that posted online. Plus, the next video we make will be test firing this thing, fired up. But I think it turned out really well. And if it works good, well, hell, this thing will be awesome. It's too bad my welding sucks. It'd really look badass if I could weld for the flip. So, next video will be us cooking on it. Got the little pop-off valve in there. I don't know if we need it, because if my wells ain't solid, they'd probably leak a little pressure. Don't be x-raying my stuff, but it looks terrible. So there she is, the rocket stove is done.